and then we'll go to SPSS. So I'll start with sharing my PPTs. So in today's session, mainly we will discuss about the research design and quantitative research design, then analysis of data with statistical method with SPSS, and we'll see how to generate the graphs and how to run the student t-test with SPSS as per the today's agenda. So these are the topics which will be taken up for discussion. As you are aware that you are doing this research session, you are told that how a research study is conducted, what are the different stages, what are the different steps. Mainly we start with the research questions, stating the aims and objective. So in order to meet this aims and objectives, we design a study, collect the data, analyze it, and conclude. So these are the main features of any research. So once you state your research question, next is you have to design your study, you have to go for your research methodology, you have to set your research methodology in order so that you will get the accurate, valid, and reliable answer for your research. So when we conduct the research, it is not only making the measurement, analyze, and get the result. So whatever results we get, they should be valid and reliable. So that important step we have to ensure in the research. So in order to be our results are valid and reliable, make sure that your research methodology is sound. So with your sound research methodology, your main objective in a research that when you get your results, you have minimized your biases and there are no confounding factors. So in order to ensure this process, we have to choose an accurate research method. So when you define your research methodology, first state your study design. It means what sort of approach you are going, whether you are going for experimental study or non-experimental study. If it is a non-experimental study, is it a survey or cross-sectional study or a prospective study or retrospective study? Or if you are going for a experimental study, is it a completely randomized design or randomized block design, pre-test, post-test? There are many designs, whether is it experimental or quasi-experimental. You have to state your who are your participants, that is target population. Since the study cannot be conducted and each and every subjects in your target population, so we are conducting the study on a sample basis. We are taking a representative sample. There is random sample. So when we are going for a conducting study through the random sample, make sure that you define your sample. So you estimate it. Sample size has to be estimated methodologically. There are different methods are there. It cannot be just simply 50. I have taken sample size of 50, 100, 200, 300, nothing like that. You have to estimate it. And when your sample target population is larger than sample size, definitely you have to go for a sampling method. Go for a random sampling instead of a purposive or convenient sampling. Though purposive and convenient sampling are very easy to conduct it, they do not have generalization. That findings are applicable to only that group. Beyond that group, you cannot go it. You can't say that these applicable results are applicable universally, what you conducted the study with, the purposive or convenience. Then if you are conducting an analytical study or experimental study, state research hypothesis. Mainly it should be positive or direct. It should be positive, means there is a definite relationship. Don't state it, there is no relationship between two factors. Then give it attention about the what all the different measurements you are making, variables, means different measurements, variables you are making. For that, which are the measurement scales are there, whether nominal, ordinal, ratio, interval. If you are estimating or testing the hypothesis, identify your independent and dependent variables, and also identify before starting data analysis what are the different statistical methods you are using to analyze the data. What sort of analysis you are using? Which are the tests you are using? Like correlation, regression, student t-test, chi-square test, ANOVA. Multivariate analysis, factor analysis, discrete analysis, all this has to be also to be added. So it becomes very easy. So with this, stating it in your research methodology, your analysis will become very easy. Then coming to the research design, as I said, based on your objective of the study, it can be qualitative or quantitative. Since today's focus is on quantitative research designs, I will be focusing on some of the quantitative research. So what is research design? A research design is the arrangement of condition for collection and analysis of data in a manner that aims combine relevant to research purpose with economy and process. Means there are different study designs are there. It should be, you have to choose in such that it is economy in terms of cost and time. there are each of the study can be conducted by different methods. So you have to choose in a such way that it is economical. So it is research upon is design is considered important because it is a conceptual structure with which research is conducted. It constitutes the blueprint for the collection, measurement, and analysis. It is, can be compared just like a blueprint of architect. While constructing a building, an architect prepares a blueprint of the building. So as per the this blueprint, all the construction goes like. There is no change, like everything goes, everybody follows that. The same way, once we design our research study, everybody, because research is conducted over a period of time, it is not one or a 2 day affair, and it involves many people. So everybody should be follow uniformly. So we have to write in record what is our research design. So when you prepare your research design, it must have a clear statement of the research problem, procedure and techniques used to gather the information, the population to be studied, and methods to be used in processing and analyzing the data. Okay, now coming to the specific design study. So when we start our study, we have to think about, does our study involves any intervention? Does we affect finding out the role of any intervention factor? It may be say teaching methods, it may be drug, it may be exercise. So there are many types of interventions. In main way business, say for example, we may undertake advertisement campaigns. So we may be interested to know to what extent our advertisement campaign was successful. We may undertake advertisement campaign through different mass media channels such as radio, newspaper, television, internet, mass individual contact. So there are different methods are there. So we have to test. Does our study involve an intervention? If it is involved, yes, we have to go for experimental study. We have to conduct an experimental study. If there is no intervention is there, we have to go for non-experimental study. In health science, it is referred as an observational study. So if there is no intervention, so observe. So most of the studies are conducted or usually observational. Experimental studies are very costly and rigorously they have to conduct it. We have to take a lot of care in while conducting the experimental, and they are costly also. So usually most of the as a researcher, especially as bigger mind, when there is no funding, usually we go for non-experimental studies. So in non-experimental studies also, in order to choose the study design for this, you have to think, does your study includes comparison? Is there any comparison between two groups? You may compare people who are exposed to certain environment, who are not exposed to environment. So this is called as an analytical study. If there is an element of comparison, there is an analytical study. If there is no comparison is there, it is called as a descriptive study. So these all types of study we have gone through this the first day is this one. During the first day presentation, we heard what are the different types of studies are conducted. So we accordingly, we choose the study. If you are going for an analytical study, you can choose a prospective study or case control study or cross-sectional study. Cross-sectional studies are usually the surveys like the surveys which undertake, they're cross-sectional in the sense that we measure all the outcome and independent and dependent variables simultaneously, and the measurements are made once only. There is no follow-up, there is no prospective study. Whereas in prospective study, there is a follow-up there, it is a longitudinal study. Say for example, TV programs are there. Like we measure the popularity of the TV serials, like whether they are ratings are increasing or decreasing. So it is mainly done through prospective study. Means we include a group of subjects. Say for example, in certain locality, we include some 100 or 200 households. We ask them about a particular program. Every week we approach them. Are you interested in this TV channel, this program, and how you are liking, whether you are liking it or like that, whether they are observing this program or not. So it is a prospect. Every week we go to them and we ask them, what is your outcome or feedback about this program? Still you are observing it or you stop watching this program? So in order to measure this ratings, usually what this do, this, marketing research agencies, they follow the prospective study. They are longitudinally enriched. And in case control study, especially in the health science studies, to identify the risk factors, they take a group of persons who are exposed to disease, who are not exposed to disease, they find out. Say, for example, heart disease. Suppose you want to find out the smoking and alcohol are associated with the development of a heart disease. So what they do in this type of gene, the researcher select a group of heart disease patients and group of patients who are not suffering from heart disease and get the information about whether they are smokers or not, whether they are consuming alcohol. So this type of study are the case. So usually this prospective and cross-sectional studies are very popular. In descriptive study, usually what we do, we conduct a cross-sectional studies, surveys. In descriptive studies, mainly we want to describe state of affairs, mainly the background characteristic of the, who are the subjects, whether men or women. Suppose a marketing company may be interested to know first, what is the background of the customers who are consuming their products? See, they want to know whether men are using their product or whether young people or old people are preferring this product. Urban or rural citizens are preferring their product. Men or women. So there are many factors they may be interested to know. This is a descriptive study. Whereas when we come to the experimental study, there is an intervention there. So when intervention is there, whether intervention is there, we require more than one group. So when we allocate them to different groups, whether we are allocating the randomly or not. If it is randomly allocated, we call it as a randomized study, like randomized control trial, or also it is called as completely randomized design. Further, it is called as randomized block design. Okay. In case of non-randomized studies, say for example, pre-test post-test is an example of non-random allocation. So we select only one group only. For one group, we select whether we make the measurement before exposure, before intervention, what was their measurement, after the intervention, what was the measurement. So based on this pre-test placement, we evaluate the effectiveness of this intervention. So this is the outline of completely randomized. Suppose we want to evaluate the different teaching methods. Now we are carrying out the online teaching methods. We may compare it with the computerized teaching in a classroom, also the formal teaching. So there are three teaching methods are there. We undertake a test at the end of the semester. We note down the score of each of the students, and then mean score we compare. Which method has yielded the highest score? So that in order to judge which teaching method is best, whether online teaching is best or whether computer aided teaching is best or classical teaching on classroom with the chalk and board is the best. So we can decide based on. So how we conduct this one? Suppose there are 150 students are there. We form a randomly three groups. Each group consists of 50 students. So randomly we select 50 students. One group will be assigned to receive the this teaching method online. Another group will be allocated to undergo the computer aided teaching in the classroom, and third group is the classical method of teaching with blackboard and chalk. So these three groups are evaluated. So intervention is the teaching method, and there are three types of teaching methods are there. So in order to evaluate this thing, this has to be completely randomized. Main feature of all this thing is randomization. So main feature of experimental studies that randomization, replication, and local control. Randomization means in order to reduce the bias, this one we have to randomly allocate this. Then replication means we have to take more than one measurement. So we are taking a sample with a specific sample size. That is replication. Your experiment should have more than one measurement. Then local control, if there is any variation is there in the outcome of this one, we have to divide it. So if in the teaching method, it is there. So instead of this one allocating all this one, we can divide the students according to this. We can students who are very good, who are moderate, and who are low in the score, their IQ. So we can classify them, and accordingly, we can divide them and allocate them. Then we can see whether this level of the intelligent and teaching methods are associated. So for that, we go for a randomized block design. This, there are two factors. Actually, it is a one way. While analyzing this data, we make use of analysis variance of one way. Or we can have only two method. Like we can have only two groups. If we are having the two groups, we can use student t-test, and we can evaluate whether teaching method A is better or teaching method B is better. If more than two groups are there, we go for ANOVA. So this is the completely randomized design. And when there are only two groups are there, we call it as between design. So when we see that there is also variation due to various factors, we divide further. Suppose we are comparing a job satisfaction in three companies. Like suppose there are three companies are there, A, B, C, and this job satisfaction score varies according to the age group. So we can divide it. We can give a representation to all of the this one. So here we select, suppose select 60 employees from group A, 60 employees from group B, and 60 employees from group C. We measure this one. So while selecting, we are dividing further in each of the companies into three groups: employees in the group 30 to 40, employees in the group 40 to 50, and employees in the group 50 to 60. Means we take 20-20 each. 20 from 30 to 40, 20 from 40 to 50, 20 from 50 to 60. So they all together 60 employees are. So we make their measurement mean score and compare them whether there is a significant difference. So this design is called as randomized block design. And also we have factorial design. Here instead of two groups, suppose if you have to compare the effectiveness of two drugs or two teaching methods, you need four groups. Suppose you are testing the effectiveness of two drugs, drug A and B. We divide the population into four groups. We divide the samples into four groups. One group will receive only drug A. Another group will receive only drug B. Third group will receive both drug A and B. And fourth group will not receive any of the drugs. Similarly, if you are testing the effectiveness of two teaching methods, teaching method A and teaching method A, what you can ensure? One group will receive teaching method A. Another group will receive teaching method B. Another third group will receive both teaching method A and B. And fourth group will not receive any of the teaching methods, and you evaluate. So this type of study design is factorial designs. So these are all experimental studies. In the experimental studies, they are randomized means. These are all randomized method. If you cannot randomize it, sometimes we don't get a comparative group. The main feature of science that in order to evaluate the effectiveness of an intervention factor, you need to have a comparative group. That is the main feature of science. Sometimes in the experiment, we do not have comparative experiment. Comparison may not be available if experimental is hazardous or destructive, is very dangerous to the those who are not exposed to that environment. Say, for example, in clinical studies, drug studies, those who are suffering from the patient particular disease, they can control, or the group who are not suffering from the disease, asking them to take a drug is very hazardous, who suffers from the side effects, so it is not advisable. So for in that situation, we go for pre-test, post-test. And pre-test, post-test also reduce the intra-measurement errors. So here what we do, we have a population of interest. We take a sample from which we want to evaluate this intervention. So what we do, we make the measurement pre-test. Before the intervention, we make the measurement, note down the outcome of interest. Then intervention, they receive the intervention. After the intervention, we make the measurement. We note down their outcome. That is pre-test measurement and post. Here also there are many diets there within, between. Within means it is a one group only. Between means you can take a more than one group. So pre-test, post also, there are different designs are there. This one is the simplest one. And based on this difference, comparing the mean change before and after, we arrive at a conclusion that the intervention was effective. Say, for example, if you are going to gym to reduce your weight, so we make the measurement before going to the gym. What was your weight? We take a random sample of some 10 or 20 persons. So these 20 subjects measurement we take, they go to gym for 6 months. After 6 months, we make their measurement, weight, body weight. So whether mean change from pre-test to post-test is significant or so, based on this, we draw a conclusion. So this is the pre-test and post-test measure. Okay, these are the designs. Various designs are there based on the objective and all the other resources available to you. You can choose the study designs. Then coming to the data analysis. So in mainly data analysis, which we carry out and report it in results. So in the results section, we answer the research question to dispute the hypothesis. They are the responses to your this one. So this task is achieved through analyzing the data collected, and it includes many tasks. You may have to prepare a table, graphs, find out the various values such as correlation, regression, chi-square test, t-test, you find the p-value. So you may have to reject the hypothesis or may not have to reject the hypothesis based on the samples. So in data analysis, it is based on these two tools, finding the descriptive statistics and finding the inferential statistics. So main purpose of data analysis is through using the SPSS to answer your research question, to achieve the stated aims and objective, to prove and refute the research question and find the p-value, test of significance. Ultimately, if there is any comparison is there, any test of hypothesis we stated, we have to provide the p-values, like what conclusion we are having. Whether our hypothesis is rejected or not. If the p-value is less than 0.05, our null hypothesis is rejected and alternative hypothesis is accepted. So this is the main phenomenon. Then what is descriptive statistic? Descriptive statistic is a first step in any data analysis. Here first what we do, we find the methods which are used to describe the data. So description of data is done with the help of presentation of data through table and graphs, summarizing further in terms of mean, median, mode, standard deviation, coefficient of variation, etc. Mainly descriptive statistics are the tools which helps us to summarize the given, describe and summarize the given data. So it is a first. Suppose if you are doing an analytical study or experimental study, it includes the testing of hypothesis. So here inferential statistics refers to, it is a process of making inference or conclusion about the target population based on sample information. You conducted a study on sample basis. So based on the sample, what you got, the findings, what you got in the samples, whether they are generalizable to the entire population or target population. So this include mainly estimation and testing of hypothesis. Estimation means making your measurement and summarizing it in terms of mean or proportion percentage. It can be point estimate or it can be interval estimate. We estimate, we have to report our findings with point estimation and confidence estimation in terms of 95% confidence interval. So suppose if you are measuring the mean, you have to provide the sample estimate of mean, also you have to provide the 95. Then testing of hypothesis. So once you are stated your hypothesis, it has to be either confirmed or refuted. So for that, we go for the testing of hypothesis. So how to analyze your data means there are different methods are there based on your purpose. You have to, if you are conducting a descriptive study, you don't have to do much. Describe the data in terms of mean plus or minus standard deviation for quantitative data, number and percentage for qualitative data. If you are conducting an analytical study, aiming to cause effect relationship, or you are evaluating the effect of intervention, we may have to go for in correlation or association studies such as regression, prediction. We may have to make the prediction, or we have to compare two or more outcomes using ANOVA or factor analysis. And mainly we report the p-values, like means what hypothesis we stated, whether it was confirmed or not, whether statistically significant finding we got or not. P-values we find. If p-value is less than 0.05, you can refer to the output, SPSS out, so that will give us the p-values. If p-value is less than 0.05, your null hypothesis is rejected and the whatever results you got, that is statistically significant. P-value is less than 0.05, it means that whatever outcome you got, that could be attributed to chances less than 5%. Okay, so how to analyze your data? There are many tasks you have to perform. As a first step, you have to describe the background to subject in a table or in graph, such as age, sex, educational qualification, their marital status, place of residence. Like that, you may have different background characteristics. For those background characteristics, represent your data in terms of table or graph. Then you have to go for the univariate analysis. Means univariate analysis means your outcome have to be compared with respect to a only independent variable. Your dependent variable is only one. That is called as a univariate or bivariate. So for example, you use the tables like chi-square test is a bivariate analysis. We are association finding the association between two variables, whether two variables are associated or not. For example, a place of residence and a preference for a product of a company. So these are the two variables we analyze using this. And if many of the, if you are a univariate or bivariate are statistically significant, then go for multivariate analysis. If suppose if you have 10 independent variables of which say 6 come statistically significant, you can go for a multivariate analysis such as logistic regression or multivariate analysis of variance in order to see among the 6 significant independent variables, which are the most significant or which are the variables, independent variables are simultaneously associated. So in order to find out the effectiveness of these independent variables which are simultaneously associated, so we go for this multivariate analysis. That is the purpose of multivariate analysis. We find independent, mainly the multivariate analysis give independent influence of each of the independent variables. So once you start your presentation of data, mainly we present it with the help of table and graphs. That is the first step. And then further we measure and summarize it in terms of mean, median, mode, range, interquartile range, standard deviation, coefficient of variation, skewness, kurtosis, etc. Mainly the skewness and kurtosis helps to you identify the shape. When we go for the testing of hypothesis, your data needs to be normal. That is, it should be symmetrical or bell shape. So whether the data is symmetrical or not, that can be evaluated through skewness and kurtosis. Okay, so for this we have to make use analysis of the data. We are using the software now. Using the software, let us see now how we can generate the descriptive statistics and how we can run the graphs as well as student TTs. So we'll come to SPSS now. Okay, so when we invoke the existing database of SPSS, this is how it looks. So this is what we call it as a data editor. When we invoke the SPSS, when we got this sheet, we call it as a, it looks like a spreadsheet, but the functions of this are not like a spreadsheet. Say for example, in Excel, in each of the cell, you can carry out the calculation, but here we cannot do any calculation, only this is for entering the data. So since I entered the data, everything is ready. You can see like age and age group, sex. So each of, so you have to arrange the data in SPSS such a way that each of the column refers to your measurements parameters in a column, and row refers to measurement related to one person. Say for example, this age of the person is 37. Age group is 20 to 39. Who is female? Religion is to illiterate. We have some coded for categorical variables. So this all measurement in row are related to one person whose serial number is 1. So we have to arrange it in a such a way that your data, you have to establish in a such a way that each of the column refer to each of your parameter of the measurement, and each of the row related to measurement related to one person. And there are many menus you can see, file like that, which is used for just like any other opening, closing, save as, this is the main feature. Then editor edit, it helps to copy paste. Apart from that, you can insert a variable. Like suppose between sex and religion, you want to insert a new variable, you can use it. Insert variable. So with that, you can insert a variable. Okay. Then view is, it helps to observe the data like that with coded, when coded data, how it could look like. Say for example, this sex and this one, earlier we used to see it as a, when we click on value variables, it indicates whether it is female or male. So this helps to observe the data, and mainly data refers to your data properties, your data. You can restructure it. You can split the file. You can select the cases randomly or specifically. You can select cases, helps to carry out the data analysis only for male, only for female, or random sample. So you can use it to make the various measurements. And transform helps to manipulate your data. Suppose if you made the measurement on height and weight, if you want to get the body mass index, you can. Suppose if you have made a measurement on per capita income and number of person in a household, you calculated the monthly income. You have measured the monthly income and number of person in the household, so you can calculate the per capita income. So many of the calculations, changing the data, coding, recoding is done with the help of time. Then most important is the analyze. So analyze helps you to carry out your statistical analysis. So analyze, you can consider it as a statistician. So based on your objective, you have to see. Say for example, if you want to get the descriptive statistics, you click on descriptive statistics, which will provide frequency table, descriptives, explore, cross tab. If you want to run the student t-test, you can select it. Compare means independent sample t-test. Suppose you want to carry out the multivariate analysis of variable, you can use the linear model multivariate. If you want to carry out the non-parametric test, you can choose. So using legacy dialects, you can run the chi-square test, two sample independent test. And it also helps to generate the various types of graph, bar diagrams, pie diagram, histogram, scatter plot, etc. Okay, this is about the SPSS. Let us how to enter this, since already it is generated. Suppose when you go for a new data set, like this, it looks like this. I'll come back again to this. Okay, this is that. So this is the blank data set when you want to generate your data set. Let us say. And at the bottom, you can see there are two views, are data view and variable. Data view is mainly for entering your data. Suppose first column of your data set is serial name, a serial number. 1, 2, 3, 4 like that. Suppose if you enter the data like this, it is generated like that. Software gives its own variable name VR001. But actually, we want it to, it is the name of this column should be serial number. So in order to name and the properties related to the variable, click on the variable. Okay, this name means it refers to name of the variable. So name of the variable is serial number. Okay, serial. Type means type of the data. So it is your data, you can enter it as numeric or alphabet means string, and our date length. So these are the three types of data we enter mainly. Numeric, if it is exclusively number, numeric, if it consists of the alphabets, use the string. If it is a date format, you can use the date, and what type of format you have to choose. Like date, month, and year format you have to choose. And width means the characteristics which you can this one. 4 digits, 5 digits. So based on the number of digits you are dealing or characteristic of the alphabet, you can set decimal place also. You want for data for 2 decimal, 3 decimal. And while naming the this one, serial name of the variable, use the short format. Don't use this long names. Suppose serial number is serial number of subject. Serial number of the subject. So you can write it in detail. When table is generated, so this label will helps you to write it in detail, the name of the variable. Suppose next is name of the person. Name of the person is not numeric as default this one. So if it is numeric, you write the name of the person in terms of alphabet, it won't accept. We have to change it here. Numeric to string. Then only it accepts. How many character stickers? Suppose we may have to some 35. 35 characteristics we want to this one. So next is aged. So you can use only 4 this one instead of having this one. 4 width is 4 and it can be one place decimal. As a male and female, we have to enter the data in terms of categorical, because when we go for higher end data analysis such as analysis of variance and if you enter it as M and F, it won't, this variable won't seen in running the regression or multivariate analysis variance or ANOVA. So we are using this one. So width is 2 only, and it has no decimal places. Gender of the, another important thing here you have to carry out is this row only. Click on the values. Here you have to assign the code what you have assigned. So here one, we assigned the value 1 for male. So when label it comes, your label value 1 as the label as male and 2 as female. Okay, add and okay, click OK. So when you generate the table, the frequency table generate the male and female. It shows the frequencies of male and female. And another important thing is about measure means what type of data. Suppose if you are having your continuous variable, it should be scale like age. Age should be here unknown is there, it should be scale only. Suppose by chance if it is either ordinal or nominal, this variable is not seen when you ask for a student detail. Suppose you want to compare the mean age between two groups, what is the average mean age of male and female, whether is it statistically significant or not. So that time, if it is not scale, if it is ordinal or nominal, what is nominal variable? Categories such as male and female, you count based on presence or this absence, marital status, married and unmarried. That is nominal. Ordinal means there is ordering of the data. Say for example, severity of disease, mild, moderate, severe. In the office, you see there is a hierarchy of employees. Such as height, weight, monthly income, age. These are all continuous variables. They are called as a scale. So you have to make sure that these measures of data is correctly stated.